Let us have a scripture. Actually, I found two scriptures, which they're exactly the same. In Luke chapter 18, verse 7, Jesus said, "The things which are impossible with men, they are possible with God." The things which are impossible to man, they are possible with God. I spoke last week, how the Lord blessed a handful of people and he answered to their prayer. And today we have a large group of hundreds of thousands of people who are believers, filled with the Holy Ghost, and serving God in the country of Italy that I can, where I come from. I also believe that if the fascist regime, who has been fighting against the Pentecostal people for since 1934, he came down and was abolished because there was a handful of people in a prayer room who were praying and praying hard for God just to deliver the people of our brothers and sisters who were condemned to be a life in prison. And that night, before they were moved from one jail to another to serve their condemnation, the Lord brought the government down and all the prisoners were freed at that particular instant. It happens in God's time, and God does have a time for things to happen. Jesus said, "Those things which are impossible with men, they are possible with God." Now, let me go leave that from last week and go into this week. My name is Joseph Roma. That's what I am. How do I know it? I don't know it. I have no idea. How can I prove that I'm Joseph Roma? There is a piece of paper that says Joseph Roma. That piece of paper was written by my father. My father went to the registration, whatever, when I was born, and he said, "I'm a proud father of a son, and that son is called Joseph Roma." Now, I know that I'm Joseph Roma because my father told me. I don't know any other way. Nobody has ever, I don't know, I was there, but I wasn't there. I was there when I was born, but I wasn't there. The reason is that I wasn't there because I didn't know what was going on. My father was there, and then he vouched for me. So that even now, at 82, I know that I am Joseph Roma only because my father told me. Nobody else. No other things nobody else knew. And the thing is that I have that piece of paper in which my father wrote, which it says that I am Joseph Roma. How do I know that he is my father? Well, because he had been taking care of me. He has been taking care of my life, provide for all of my things that I have need of as I grew up, and therefore He has given me everything that he could in order that I could grow up. Day by day, I was in my father's care. He was taking care of me. And my father was also faithful in whatever he was providing. And my father was always providing the right things at the right time. He never gave me everything I wanted. No. But he did give me what I was in need of. And I remember many times that I wanted certain things, but my father said, no. And he didn't have to say much. All he had to say, that like this with his head, and that's it. You know my father, when he said something, it was going to happen. And if he says no, it was no. And that's it. And there was no worrying about it, no complaining about it, because I could get down on the ground and scrounge and scream and shout and do anything I wanted. He said no, and it was no. But I could count on him. When I was young, I was traveling in the city of Naples, and one night I came out of the office and I was very tired, and I just wanted fresh air. So I got out of the office and I began to walk down the street. Now, in those days, you couldn't walk down the street unless you have an older person with you. And I was too young to walk down the street. And before I went around the block, two policemen came close to me, in plain clothes, came close to me, and they said, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I'm just going for a breath of fresh air." He said, "Where you come from? You're not from here." I said, "No, I come from Rome, which is about 200 kilometers away from here." And I said, "I come from Rome. But I said, I was working in that office right over there." He said, "How do I know you were working in that office over there? You could be just one of those kids going around and doing a lot of kind of troubles all over the place." I said, "Oh, no, I'm not." He said, "I can give you my father's name. You can call my father, and my father will vouch for him, for me." And you know what? They did take my father's name. They did take my father's telephone number. They did go and call my father. And lo and behold, even though my father didn't know where I was, he was there vouching for me. And he said, "Oh, yes, I have a son that is called Joseph. Oh, yes, he's down in Naples. Oh, yes, he's going down," he said, and so on. So he vouched for me. Therefore, I can, no matter how much trouble I have caused to him, he was always there, ready and willing to come in my rescue. God is my father. Does he give me everything I want? No. But does he give me the things that I need? Yes. He is my father. And therefore, he's in charge. He knows exactly what I need. He knows exactly what I have where I am, and whatever I do, anything, he will take charge and he will vouch for me. Now let us talk about the ministry. That is my father. All right? My natural father, he passed away. He's with the Lord. But I still have my father up there. He never passes away because he's yesterday, today, and forever. And he's still watching over, and I'm pretty sure he's listening to what I'm saying right now. In the year 1949, the Lord called me into the ministry, and God promised for me to keep me and to provide everything that I was in need of for the rest of my life. I told you what happened in the beginning when I had to go to England and I didn't have the money, and the money came in the last minute, and that's what God does. He always comes to the last minute. He drives you down to the edge. But I went. 1950 to 53, I was in college. You were not born yet, but I was in college in England, and I spent two years over there. And after those 2 years, in 1953, in the month of April, can't remember that, I came back to Rome and I began into the ministry. My first assignment, it was to go down to certain region in Italy to stay with a friend of mine and to be able to learn the ropes and be able to preach to the others. So I call those years the years of evangelism. I had I didn't have any responsibility. My responsibility was to go out and preach the gospel, have see people saved, and also to encourage the church for revival. And that's what I did for some period of time. My second assignment, after a few months that I was down there, there was a conference. I went up to the conference, and by the way, nobody ever offered me any money, and I didn't have any money, and the people at church were not used to collect money to give to the preacher when he came, so that's just one of those things. I didn't worry about the money because I was working for God, and he was the one, he promised that he was going to supply, and he did. because I didn't starve. I'm still here. I didn't. I traveled around, and because I was going from one place to another, and therefore I was working for God, and that's all. My father up there, and he was able to take care of me in everything that I needed. And so after that, I was asked to go into, after the conference, I was called up into the office of the superintendent, and he said to me, he said, Joseph, we would like you to go to a certain town. We don't want you to go. You're still in the beginning of your ministry. We don't want you to be alone and be far away from home. I want you to go to a certain town. Now, this town is a town which is about 110 kilometers away from Rome itself. I could have come home anytime I wanted to, but that is the town which we went. And I knew the town because as young people, and remember, as young people, we used to go by bus in that particular town just to encourage the local members of the church and also to bring a little bit of revival into the town itself. But in this particular town, I remember so well that after the service, that we left the service to go back into the bus, the people were standing outside the road, one on one side and on the other, a long line of people shouting and cursing and doing all kinds of things as we had to go by to them to go into the bus. There was no other way that we could have gone, and they were there cursing and shouting, and some of them were throwing stones, some of them were spitting at us as we were going by. And so all we had to do is just binding together. It was about 29 or 30 of us binding together and walking quickly to go into the bus. We got into the bus, and the leader said, is any of you hurt here? Nobody was hurt. You see, I believe that when those were throwing stones, my father, which is up there, he sent the angels down there, and he does that, by the way. He does send the angels, for angels are the ministers that they have come to minister to us when we are in need. And I believe that God has sent angels, and those angels were throwing the stones and the spits out of the way, and no one of us was ever hit, not by the stone, neither by the spit. And the curses, well, you let them go. And for God does take care of you. And that is the town in which was my first pastoral experience in which I had to go into. Interesting. God always sends you where you don't want to go. Okay. There was also another town which was not far away from there. And by the way, these towns and names are written in the book of the history, so you can check if it's true or not, if I was there or not, that's up to you. There was also another town which was not far away, a few kilometers away on the other side of the mountain, and I was supposed to take care of that particular group of people as well. And so I didn't have any transportation. The man that I was staying with, he had a brand new push bike. And he said to me, he said, Pastor, he said, if you want to, you can use my push bike to go to the church, have the service, and come back. He said, just don't worry about it. You can have the bike. I wish it was a motorbike, because going up in those hills is not that easy. But there I went with a bike, and I did that for quite some time. One night, one night was a stormy night. Wasn't a very good night. And as I was finished the service, one of the deacons came up to me and he said, Pastor, you better don't talk too long. He said, just hurry up and go, because there is a big storm coming up. And he said, you're not going to make it home unless you really hurry up. And so I said, okay, thank you very much. I got into the bike and I jumped out of the bike. In those days, man, I was young. I had long hair. I had strength, and I think I was even taller than what I am now. But anyway, I jumped on the bike and I began to. And I began to go back home. And as I was keep going to the bike and pushing hard, going up to the hills, suddenly the light went. You know those old dynamo In the back, yeah. Well, the bike went. It was dark, pitch dark. The clouds were closed and the thundering was thundering all over the way. I was just almost at the top of the mountain and the dogs were howling from all over the place and he gripped the fear into me. And I didn't know, I mean, I didn't like that particular kind of situation. And I began to try to fix up the light into the bike because I couldn't see a thing. But there is no way I could fix it. The bike did not want, the light did not want to come up, and there was no way that those lights were going to come up. Now, I did something that I don't want you ever to do it. And I have never told anybody except my wife this particular thing. But I'm telling you because you're my brothers and sisters. And I know that you understand what I'm saying. So there I am in the middle of a country. The dogs were howling. The storms were raging, coming up very strongly. And the clouds were there. The thundering was all over the place. There I was all by myself, far away from any home. I couldn't go anywhere. And I said, where am I? What am I going to do? Then a thought came into my mind. Have you ever heard that scripture that say, your word is a light into my pathway? Ah, I said, that's it. I got the Bible out of my pocket. Generally, I carry my pocket. Those were, I could see well in those days. So I had a small Bible and I took the Bible out of my pocket. I took off my belt. I put the Bible right in top of the light. The light didn't want to work. I put a Bible on top of it. I tied with my belt the Bible into the... Now, I really did that. I mean, that's stupid. I know it's stupid, but I actually did it, you know, and I can't help it. So I put that thing in the light, and then after the Bible was nice and tied in, secure on top of the light, I said, now, Lord, your word is a light into my pathway. I'm going to jump on this bike and I'm going to go home and that's it. You know what? I went home. Went up to the hill, down the hill. I mean, those mountains are pretty high. If you go off the little pathway, you're done. You're it. You know, you never get up until the following when they find you over there and that's it. But I got home. And as soon as I entered the door, the rain began. See, my Father takes care of me. God is my Father. He takes care of me. Yeah. I have to believe that. And how do I believe that? I believe the word in which is written. I know that I'm Joseph Roman because it's written on a piece of paper which my father wrote. I know that I am a Christian because it's written on a piece of paper in which my father wrote. That's why I know that I am saved and born again. That's why I know that I am going towards heaven, that I'm walking towards heaven. That's why I know that when I'm in trouble, he's coming and take care of me. Why I know? Because it's in that piece of paper. In that piece of paper that it seems the devil can keep coming and saying, it doesn't mean anything. It is written for everybody. Anybody can be there. But I tell you, that paper bears my name. And my name is written in the book. Lives of heaven. And when my name was written in the book's light of heaven, my father is bound by that writing to take care of me every day of my life until I go up to stay with him forevermore. It's happened to me. It's just one of those things. You know, sometimes we want to make things big. We want to say, oh yeah, but how? And I grew up, unless you pray for 24 hours a day, unless you are constantly in touch with God. I was told when I was a boy never to go to the movie. And I said, why not? Because if Jesus comes and you are in the movie, you're going to be left behind. And I believed it. Why? Because they were grown ups. Then I began to realize that my Father is my Father, and no matter where I am, He takes me out of there, because the Spirit will quicken my body, and I'm going no matter where I am, I'm going. He doesn't tell me, don't go here, don't do this, and don't do the other. He tells me, wherever you go, bring me with you. That's what He wants you to do, and that's what He wants us to do. That was my first assignment, the second assignment, by the way. That wasn't easy. My third assignment was the assignment of pastoral, and that's what I was doing in that particular church. My last assignment in Italy, I was called into the office. I was given a piece of paper. Here there is an address, and this is the name of some people who are asking for help. We want you to go down there and help them and see what the situation is and start a church if it's necessary. And he said, yeah, but we want you to go down there. So I got down there. By the way, I never told you how the Lord provided a salary for me. It's unbelievable. While I was in a conference, there was a speaker that came from the United States, and I didn't know him, never spoke to him, never know him. But after the conference was over, the superintendent called me up to the office, and he said, I want you to know that so-and-so, who was the speaker at the conference, has promised to go back to America and to raise some money for your support, for your ministry. He said, the Lord spoke to him directly and said, I want you to provide for that young man. Now, there is a lot of other people there. There are 220 pastors at that particular time who were coming, and they all needed some support or another. But the Lord spoke to him and he said, I want you to talk to that particular person. He didn't even know my name. He didn't know who I was, but my Father knew. He knew my name. And so he went, and he did provide. Then I went to visit him when I went to America, and I thanked the church personally. There I was sent into this particular place called Sir Chiara, in the middle of nowhere, on top of the mountain. In Italy, all the towns are on top of the mountain, by the way, so it's not unusual. And I went up there. And my going up there in those days, after I knew that I had a salary, I went out and I said, I'm not going to go push bike anymore. So I went out and I got myself a little Godzi, you know, one a little motorbike with an engine underneath there, and that will take me anywhere I wanted to go. And so I got on my motorbike, I put my little suitcase in the back, I tightened it up nice and well, and there I went to this place which I have never seen, never known, I didn't even know where it was. As I was going up there, my first opposition came spiritually. How do you know that many things are first fought spiritually and then materially they are going to come to happen? And so as I was climbing up to the mountain, the road was going zigzag like that. And as I was going getting closer to the mountain, it seems like that a strong wind blew me and my bike almost at the edge of going over. And somehow, I didn't think of anything. I said, oh, well, it's windy up here. So I keep going, and I went to the next turn, and another gust wind came and almost blew me out of the place. Now, when it happened once, I'm simple enough to just accept it the way it is. But when it happened the second time and the third time, you start thinking about it and said, hey, just a minute, something is going wrong here, and something is not right. So I stopped the bike, I turned the engine off, I got out of the bike, I looked all around the place, and I said, in Jesus' name, I am Son of the Living God, and therefore nobody can touch me. I am anointed to preach the gospel, and I'm here to preach the gospel. So let any power, any dominion to leave me alone, because I am going to do the job anyway. I got back into the bike, they never had any troubles. Until then, no more. Whoa, victory! Then we came to, I went to see the people, and we began to, we rented a garage somewhere, or a storefront, and actually was given to us a storefront, and we began to have preach the gospel. And as I began every night, I only had a couple of chairs. I did the I didn't take up the offering. But I did the singing, I did the preaching, I did the setting up of the church, I did everything that everybody else does. You know, you have to do, that's it. Put the lights on, make sure that everything is all right, and it's going great. And people start coming in, listening to the gospel. They wanted to know, with this young man coming from far away, with the new news, something that is different. Let's go and hear what he's got to say. And so they were coming. The priest got notice of it. And early in the morning and the early mass, he always said to the people, don't ever go and listen to that young man who is coming from far away. He's going to throw you away from the Holy Mother Church. And, you know, Italians, very funny people. Very funny people. You tell them not to do something, they're going to do it. So he actually did me a favor, because people were coming in and listening. They wanted to know, and they wanted to know more. And the place suddenly was full. I had to go looking for chairs all over the place. I mean, it was a small place. It wasn't 100 people. But even 25 people, it looked like it was full to capacity. And so we started the service. One night, something happened. They couldn't shut us up by any legal means, because we were legally doing the right thing. So one night, a group of young people, I think we're a group of young people, I don't know, while we were having the service, they put a bonfire right in front of our place. And when the fire was rising strong, the flames were nice and high, with a pitchfork, they threw the flames inside where we were. Now, I was preaching. I tell you what, I stopped preaching. I saw fire coming down, you know. I mean, you have to start really worrying about it for a bit. And the fire, and there is people over there, and then people can get burned. And so I stopped preaching and trying to make sure that fire wasn't touching the people, you know, trying to help somehow, some way. But we went through that night, and the thing was over, and therefore the fire didn't touch anybody, and so they stopped doing it, because they couldn't win in that direction. Today, 2015, there is a church there, which is still there, and they still have sent me greetings from time to time. They remember the old man. And they are still there. There is a church which is there, which God has started by the power of His Holy Spirit. God, what is impossible to man, it is possible with God. God will take care of you, and He will take care of me. In 1956, I was called to the army. That's it. I had to learn how to stand up and how to greet and how to march and all those kind of things. But every time I went into some kind of interview or whatever, I always said, I'm a minister of the gospel. Now, I know that some of them didn't even know what minister of the gospel meant, but they had to write down what I said, and so I'm a minister of the gospel, and that's what I am. And we were not recognized by the government as yet, and therefore I was on my own, if you can look at that. So I went there. I went to the army, and this, I believe, I want you to listen to this, because it stands to the point that God does take care of you if you let Him take care of you. And sometimes the devil come and he keep telling us, he said, oh yeah, but it's only in your imagination, it's in your mind. How do you know it is for you? I know, because how do I know my father is my father? Because it's written a piece of paper. And not only that, now, of course, they have a DNA, and they try, and they know for sure if he is your father or not. Well, they can try my DNA, and I know that I'm a Christian, because I'm born again, and because I walk down the street with the DNA of the Lord God Himself, and so He is my father. Went to the army, and I was Everybody was telling me how hard it was going to be and how bad it was going to be and everything like that. I was there 3 days. They have just about given me the uniform and I was ready to be assigned somewhere when I was called up and they said, we want you to be on the cleaning roster tomorrow morning. And I said, okay, what do I have to do? Well, he said, there is a group of you. He said, he's in charge and he'll tell you what to do. So I went there ready to do the cleaning. You know the preaching is doing cleaning as well? Yeah. I tell you what, sometimes you do some cleaning that you don't want to do, but you still have to do it. So anyway, the corporal come to me and he said, Joseph, he said, what you do? He said, you go in front of everybody else and take everything that is under the bed and put them in top of the bed and so that we can come with a mop and everything and clean up and it would be easier for the people following. So I did. I went in front of everybody else and I picked up everything was under the bed and put them in top of the bed and lo and behold, as I was doing that, I found a pocketbook. Somebody have left it under the bed. And I looked at that pocketbook, I opened it up and man, there was a lot of money there. So I got scared. I didn't know what to do, so I called up the corporal. I said, look, fellow, I just found a book here. There is a lot of money in there. I don't want this guy to say that I stole the money from him, so please count the money and do whatever is the things to do. So he did. First, he looked at me funny, because generally what you do, you take the money out, you put the thing under the bed, and you keep going. Yeah, that's a natural thing to do. But see, I have the DNA of my father. I don't do that. You understand that? Because I have the DNA from up there. So anyway, he took the thing and he took it to the lieutenant, and the lieutenant took it up to the office and so on and so on. That afternoon, the lieutenant came marching up to where I was sleeping and he said, are you Joseph Roma? I said, yes. Do you have a clean a uniform to go outside to go out? I said, yes, they just gave it to me yesterday. I don't know how it fits me, but I have it. He said, put it on, I'll come back in half an hour and pick you up. So I put the uniform on, there you come. And I walked behind him and we went to the captain's office. As soon as we got into the captain's office, it got into the end, the captain came from outside the desk and he came up and he shook hands to me and he said, I am honored to have an honest person in my battalion, whatever it was. I don't know, I never made a difference between a battalion, a regiment and the others. To me, they're all the same. But into my battalion. So he came and shook hands and he sat down and he asked very clearly to me, why didn't you keep the money? And I said, because my DNA from there, I'm born again, I'm a Christian and so on. So he looked in my paper, he said, minister, what does that mean? Why you are not a Catholic like everybody else? Why are you different? And so I began to tell him why I was different and so on and so on and start preaching the gospel to him. Man, I could care less. I just sat there and he asked for it. That's it. And he can get it. He can get as much as he can. And so he after he left and the following Sunday, every Sunday, the old battalion had to battalions and come as a regiment and in the big square. And the priest will come and perform a mass, Catholic mass for everybody. And of course, I wouldn't want to go. I'm not a Catholic. What am I going there for? What am I going to listen to? He said, there is nothing there to listen. So I said to the captain, I said, by the way, sir, I'm not a Catholic. I'm not coming Sunday morning. And he said, oh, well, that's fair enough. Okay. So you tell to the lieutenant, he's got permission not to come. So I didn't go. So every Sunday, I began to, it was not too far away, just about a week go by, when I was called again, and this time, the colonel wants to see me. And in front of all the regiment, I marched between the lieutenant on one side, the captain on the other. I was in the middle, up to the podium where the colonel was, and he showed me to the colonel. He came up and he said, "I'm glad to have an honest person in my regiment. I'm really fair." And he turned to the captain and said, did you give something to honor what this man has done?" And the captain said, "No, not yet, but I was thinking about sending him home with 5 days, 7 days paid trip to send him home for Christmas." And the colonel said, "Oh, well, if that's, he's happy with that, that'll be good." And so I was the first soldier who in the army who went home for Christmas after not even 2 months that I was there, and that is a no-no. Because nobody goes anywhere, any place. But you see, yes, you know what I'm talking about. You see the Father and the Father. You see what He provides and He provides. You see the things, how they come, as easy as they come. So I went. It was only when I came back from a holiday that I was reading the Bible under the tree while everybody here was a mess, when one young man came up to me and he said, "What are you reading?" I said, "I'm reading the Bible." He said, "Is that a Catholic Bible or is this a Pentecostal Bible?" I said, "Well, Bible is all the same, but this is a Pentecostal Bible, just to make it clear to you." He said, "How come you are here?" He said, "I'm Pentecostal and they give me all the dirtiest jobs and I can't do nothing." And he said, "How come you are here all dressed up and having time on your own?" I said, "Oh, well, I don't know." He said, "But who is giving you the hard trouble?" He said, "Oh, well, over there." He said, "Give me all the dirty jobs because I don't want to go to mass in the morning. They give me all the dirty jobs." Then that thing came to me. He's a son of God too. And he is one that is born with the power, is born in the spirit. He does have the rights just like everybody else. I am the pastor. He's the member of the church, so I take over. And I went to him and I said to him, "Go back, put yourself a uniform, a clean uniform, and come back here." Oh, he said, "They'll kill me." I said, "Don't worry about it. I'll take the funeral. Just that, care no about nothing, is that you just go over there and you do that." And so he did. He went back to his place and he told the corporal that was in charge. He said, "I've been told to put my uniform and to go outside there." And he started yelling and cursing and shouting. And he said, "Who told you that?" He said, "I'm the boss here." He said, "Yeah, but somebody outside there told me." So he came rushing to me. He started looking if I had any before they talk. You know, they are afraid of that. And so they start. I didn't have any. I was just a simple soldier, just like everybody else. So he started cursing and shouting at me and telling me all kinds of things and yelling, really yelling. And while he was yelling, I said, "You know that according to the military rule, you being a corporal and all, you should know that. You're not supposed to swear. You're going against the rule of the government here. And therefore, you're not supposed, you want to talk to me naturally." While I was talking to him, the lieutenant came by. Lieutenant and I had become friends now because he was keep talking to me about the things of God. He wanted to know more and more. So he went by and he said, "Hey, Roma, what's happening?" I said, "Well," I told him, "this is what's happened." And I said, "Sir, up to now I was by myself. I took the Bible, I bothered nobody. I had my devotion under the tree. God will answer just the same. But now it's the two of us. And therefore, I need a place where we can come together and worship God just like everybody else." Well, he said, "You're asking a little bit too much," he said, "but I'll come back to you." And he did come back to me within an hour. He came back and he said to brought me to the captain again, and I told the captain what I wanted to do. He asked me what I wanted, and he said, "Okay," he said to the lieutenant, "find a room that he's pleased with, that he's happy with, put some chairs in there, table, whatever he needs over there, and let him go." The following Sunday, we started the service. We start preaching the gospel. Many of the soldiers, of course, we always had our 25 to 30 soldiers that they didn't want to stand up over there, so they'd rather come and listen to what I had to say. And so they were there, and they were there to listen to the preaching of the gospel. The DNA that is upon you, it is the strongest point that you can ever think of. You are who you are because you have been born again by the power of God and by the Spirit of God. That DNA is in you, and that DNA gives you the power to remove scorpions and serpents. That DNA gives you the power to open door and to close door, because it's written in the book. It is written in the piece of paper. It is written over there. You don't open closed door just because you feel like, but it is written over there. You can do it. And if you can do it, why not? Therefore, as a church, we are able to do all of those things by the power of God, by the glory of God, because the DNA of the Lord is upon us. And because I am a child of God, because you are a child of God, and you can be young, you can be old, you can be no matter what you are. It doesn't make any difference. My Father is eternal, and he lived yesterday, today, and forever, and he's able to take care of you. He's able to take care of me. He's able to take care of anybody. Because he's my God. He's the God in heaven. And therefore he does all things. Did I do it? No, I didn't. I only follow the paper. Do I know that I'm Joseph Roma? Yeah, I know. Do I doubt it? No. Sometimes when I was a teenager, I did doubt it. I had some kind of funny questions in my mind, and those funny things that come to your head, and you start doubting certain things. But now, I don't doubt it anymore. I mean, my Father said he's my Father. I can't prove it. I don't know. I wasn't there. I mean, I was there, but I didn't know what was going on. I didn't understand it. But he said that he is, and therefore he is. God was there when you were born. When you were born, yes. When you were born. Yes. And it doesn't matter if you understand it or not. Once you know that you come and your Savior saved, your heart has been washed with the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. When all the things that you wanted to do, you are not going to do them anymore, because the DNA that you have in you is not going to make you do it anymore, and you are doing other things. And therefore, you know that you are. I know. Because he takes care of me. I know my Father because he took care of me. Because he was with me until he died. I remember the last thing that I ever remember of my Father. He had an apartment in Rome. And my wife and I, we went over there. And the apartment was a small one. Of course, he had to out of his bedroom in order for us to have the bedroom, and he goes somewhere else, and he had those things done. And my sister said, maybe there is an empty apartment where I am, and that I know the people, you can come here and stay here. So I go home and said to my father, I said, "Dad," said, "there is an empty apartment where my sister lives," said, "we can have it, we can go and live there, it will be more comfortable for you and for us." He looked at me and he said, "You, my son, this is my home, this is your home. You go nowhere but here." When my father said that, that's it. Now, my friend, let me tell you, this is the home, the house of God, isn't it? And he wants us to be here. Why? Because he delights in having us here. Otherwise, he would send us anywhere else, but he didn't. He delights us to come in here. How can we then dare going anywhere else? How do we dare? Is that what God wants us to do? Is that what my Father is pleased with? Certainly not. He will only be pleased when I do things that are good to him. One more thing and then I quit. Hallelujah. Somebody said, "Brother, if you, I'll bring a chair up to you." No, I don't want a chair. If I can't stand up, I don't want a chair. And in after the army in 1957. In 1957, time goes fast, doesn't it? The Lord, I had to go back into the ministry, so I thought I was going back to the same thing that I was doing before. But now other people have taken over whatever I have left behind. I had to find a new thing. And I was thinking that the Lord was giving me a desire of going outside of the country, which is not what I really wanted to do. I was born in Rome, and Romans don't leave the country. They stay there because it's a nice city to live in. And you just don't want to go out. But the Lord began to speak to me of going out of the country. So I said, well, if I have to go out, okay, we'll talk about it. So one day, I didn't want to go. I just didn't want to go. I wanted to stay there. I just don't want to go anywhere. This is my home, and that's where I want to be. I have never had problem with my throat. I'm 82 years old, never had a problem with my throat. I can preach and shout as much as I want to, never had a problem. God always put his hands on it. But this particular time, I had problem with my throat. I couldn't eat, I couldn't drink. So my mother said to my sister, take him to the hospital and see what's happened. So she took me to the hospital, and the doctor said, well, he said, you got an abscess in your throat, a big thing in there. He said, we have to cut it, so we have to operate on it, make an appointment, come back, and we'll operate, and the whole thing will be okay. Now, don't talk to me about operation and hospital. I don't know much about it. I've never been in one. I don't know what goes on. And I went home, and I said, Lord, I've been anointed to preach the gospel, and I can't because my throat hurts. And I don't know why my throat hurts, and I don't understand what's going on. Tomorrow I'm supposed to have an operation, and I don't like operation either. So, Lord, what are we going to do? And as I was praying, I laying in my bed and praying in my room, suddenly he looks like if out of the side of the room there was a big round light. It was like a rainbow. Turning like this. It was turning all the colors. And as that light was coming, moving into the rain, I stopped talking and I began to look at the light, trying to figure out what was happening. And I said, Lord, what is this that I see? And the Lord said, I had to bring you that problem in your throat because you were not listening to what I have to tell you. Can he do that? I thought God only heals. Can he do that? Yes, he did. He did it to me. Probably I can take it, but he did it to me. I don't want it to do it to you, but he did it to me. And so I said, well, Lord, I am listening, and now I'm listening, and I want to know what is your will, what you want me to do. And the Lord said very clear to me, he spoke to me very clear, I want you to leave the country. As soon as the Lord said, I want you to leave the country, somebody knocked at the door, the whole thing went, and that's it. And I was left in the lurch. Leave the country and go where? Where am I going to go? I don't want to leave the country. Now God tells me to leave the country. Where am I going to go? What's going to happen? So I thought to myself, oh, well, there is a lot of migrants going to Belgium, to Germany, to France, and all over the places. That maybe I can go over there. I can always take the train and come back here anytime I want to come. You know, I can come home anytime I want to. But all the doors closed down. I had so many friends and all the doors were closed. I couldn't go to France. I couldn't go to Germany. I couldn't go. I went to school with some of those people over there that now they were pastors, and I couldn't go anywhere. All the doors were closed. One day I get a call, and I took one of the missionary around Rome. I used to do that quite often, to show them the places and show them all of the historical places and so on. And the man was middle-aged man. He started being interested in what I was doing, and he wanted to know what I was doing and so on. So I told him, I went to Bible college. I'm just waiting to go back into the ministry and so on and so on and so on. And he said something very funny to me, something that somebody else said it before, but I refused. He said, "Why don't you come to America?" I said, "I don't want to go to America. I have no affinity with America whatsoever." He said, "My work is called among the Italians, and the Italians are in Italy, by the way, if you don't know, but that's where they are. So this is where I want to be. That's my call, is to the Italians." And very little I knew that all the doors were closed. So he left his address, put it in my pocket. He boarded the plane and he went. We prayed about it, talked about other people and so on. And it seemed that the Lord was leading in that way. As soon as I decided to go in that direction, I wrote him a letter and I said, it seemed that the Lord praying about it, and the Lord is dealing us to, about that way. Immediately, I got all the necessary paper that I needed to be filled up to go to the consul and to the American consulate and to be able to do all of those papers. Do you know that within a month and a half, I left the country, I was on a boat, and I was in New York? Now, that's impossible. It doesn't happen that easy. It doesn't happen that far, that easy and that quick. But I went to the American consulate. I put all the papers. I made an application for a visa. And I said to the secretary, I said, "Look, if you don't give me the visa by a certain time," I said, "I don't want to go. I want to go to America. I want to go to school. Therefore, I'm going to college, and I want to be there. By the time college opens up, I'm not going to go waste another year until next year." I said, "That's it. That's it. That's it." So she said, "I'll make an appointment. You talk to the consulate. To the council." So she made an appointment, and the following day I got all nice and dressed up. I'm funny, but when I have to do something that is important, I get all nice and dressed up. I want people to take notice of it. And when I went all my nice clothes and I went to talk to the council, I sat over there. He asked me a few questions, and it just happened that he was at the court when the when we fought the government and we went to court and we won the case, by the way, for recognition as the Assemblies of God, as a religious organization. He was there listening, sitting there listening. And I said, "I was there too listening." And so we started talking. And he started talking about what's your work and what you're doing and so on and so on. Then he went through a few papers and he said, "I see no reason why you can't leave tomorrow." You know that man, he will remember, my father came to visit me while I was in America, and he remembered my father, and he gave him the visa just like that, because he said, "Oh yeah, I know your son, he's over there." Then, you know, your father up there, he does a lot of things that you don't expect him to do, but he will do it, because he leaded my pathway. As I walked through this life, he leaded my pathway, until one day, I reached to the end of my pathway, and the power of God will come upon me, and the Spirit of the Lord will translate me in a twinkle of an eye. And those who are dead, of course, they'll be first, and then I will follow right after them. And the trumpet will sound, and we shall be up in the air to be with the Lord forever and forever and forever. But as we are here, and as long as we are here, let us remember that we have the DNA of our Father, and our Father is there, and He will take care of things. We might not understand what we are going through and why we are going through. We might feel depressed, and we might feel discouraged, and we might feel pain, and we might feel all those kind of things. But the Bible tells me that I'm making through. Even when I go through the fire, on the other side of the fire, there will be the hand stretch of the power of God, and I will be with Him forever and forevermore. Thank God. Thank God. We're going to make it, man. We're going to make it.
Amen.
All we got to do is to believe.
Yes.
For all things are possible. I read scripture, right? Things are impossible to men, but they are possible to God. So God can do it. Don't think for a minute that whatever you're going through or whatever is happening to you is impossible to be done. It's possible because with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
And we're going to make it. Let us stand for a minute, shall we? I believe. Do you believe? Do you believe why? Because you saw something? Or you believe because your DNA is with God? Do you believe because it just happened that you have seen something that God has done? The Jewish people that were asking Jesus for signs, and Jesus said there will be no sign to this generation. Why? Because if I have a sign, it's easy to me to believe, and tomorrow I forgot. But if I believe that my DNA is with God, therefore now I'm seated at the right hand of God with Jesus Christ, my brother and my Savior. I'm sitting with Him in the right hand of God, and therefore I am part of the family of God.
That's what I believe.
And I believe it not because He has to prove it to me. I believe it because it's written on that piece of paper, and He does not come short of that piece of paper. My name is Joseph Roma. How do I know it? My father says so. I am born again. How do I know it? Because my says so. And if my father says so, I am born again, man. And if my father says so, I am going to make it. And if my father said, I'm going to watch upon you until you die, I'm going to trust that He's going to watch upon me. Even if I am far away. There I was 200 kilometers away from home. The police calls up. My father could have gone in hysteria. I know what happened. He said, no. He said, I know Him. Yep, I know Him. He is my son. And therefore, you just let Him go because I know He's there and He is my son. Are you in trouble this morning that you're going through the hardship of life? Just remember that God is saying to you today, I know you. I know you. And all those troubles, He says, leave Him alone because He is my son. He is my son. Hallelujah. 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 I believe because it's written. I don't believe because God spoke to me. That's only consequences that come. I don't believe because God has provided for me. Those are consequences that come. I expect Him to do so. Because He's my Father. But those are consequences that will come. I believe because it's written. Written on a piece of paper. Aha. And that is in my hand now. It's the testament of is what we do every Sunday. It is the proof of a new covenant. The covenant of a new testament. As our brother said. In the covenant of the New Testament, and I believe because I believe in that.
Amen.
What's your problem today? What's your problem today? Are you going through a hard time? Are you going through hardship?
Can you hear me?
That's not a problem. See, I don't live for this thing here. I live for that up there. Those are the problems of the flesh. They're not the problems of the spirit. What is your problem today? What is your unbelief? What will be for God to make you believe? I'm not going to ask for a miracle. I want to believe. Because it is written. And it's written today. That you can be freed.
Yeah.
You can be free.
Yeah.
And you believe is going to be done. Let's have a little bit of prayer. We are going to anoint like we generally do for everybody else. But let us come with a believing. Let us come with a new stretch of mind, believing of what God is going to do and what He can do. So when I come, I don't come just because it's another day, another anointing with oil. I come because I believe. While I walk, when you walk to here, keep telling yourself, I am a child of God. My Father is the God in heaven, and everything can happen.
Amen, brother.
Everything can happen.
Give Joe a big round of applause.